Sweet guys, so let's get started real quick. So as I mentioned, every single time I am going to give you guys like a quick presentation on like some product that was successful. So MyFitnessPal, how many of you guys have heard of MyFitnessPal? One. So has anyone heard of calorie counting? Calorie counting is what you do when you want to actually lose weight. So if you want to lose weight, you calorie count. And that's to measure how much intake you have into your body. So MyFitnessPal started off as a website. I'm sure you guys can tell it's not a very nice looking website, but this is how it looked from the beginning. So this one guy, his name was Mike, he decided to build this because he wanted to lose weight for his wedding. And so, Harley, this applies to you. So he spent all this time, like, you know, he tried all these different diets that people were talking about, and then the doctor who he consulted was like, the only way to lose weight is you count calories. So he started building this website, and he got it up, and it failed miserably. He got like 10 to 20 people on the website, and he was like, this is complete failure. And then he went, and he had quit his job at this point, and he went and got a job. So the thing about it is that the best way is calorie count, but you have to punch in how many calories you intake at any given point. And so on in the U.S., every single place has these things, and they would fill it out one at a time. So it's terrible, absolutely terrible, right? Because everyone had to punch it in. Turns out a lot of people eat the same product. So once one person punches it in, it's there for everyone to use, right? So now let's say person one punches in 100 items, second person comes in and types in, oh, I want to look up how much this Coke is, right? It's already in there. So it turns out that he waited for a year, and he came back a year later, and he saw his database was completely full. Like the zealots, these people who want to lose weight, they, you know, spent all this time, and they basically like typed in like the entire food database. So it turns out that this crowdsourcing thing actually really worked. And then mobile came around, and then they could scan barcodes, and then they automatically pre-fill their data. So they actually sold to Under Armour for $450 million. Turns out they had, because of all the information that they took in, all these people punching in all this data for them, they were able to basically collect all the data. They have more nutrition data than the USDA, which is the nutrition or basically the nutrition, the government nutritional space. So basically, tackle a space that affects many, many people, but initially build something only a zealot would use. So that's kind of the takeaway from that. Cool. Oh, no worries. All right, so let's go over homework two really quick. So one of the things that we did was, you guys all did a great job. Really proud of you guys for all the work that was done. But one of the things I want to retouch on is actually the stuff that we went over last time. So as many of you guys know, I basically created a new adapter every single time we did a search. The thing that you guys should take away, and probably what you guys learned from your own projects, was that you should not create an adapter every single time. Please reuse an adapter, because you basically wipe away all your view holders and stuff like that. And of course, the nice thing is for adapters, you can notify changes, right? So if I have an adapter here, I can notify that things have changed, and then your recycler view will optimize how to draw accordingly. So how many of you guys use that feature in your homework? Hands? How many of you guys use that feature in your homework, the notify? Whenever you made like a new call, instead of like recreating an adapter. Show of hands. Close if you didn't. Open if you did. Cool. Everyone raise your hands. Closed if you didn't use the notify. So open if you did. Yeah, raise your hand.
Participate.
Yeah, everyone, okay. Cool, ready? 1, 2, 3. All right, sweet. Awesome. So let's kind of go over and take a look at some of the work that was done. So we, Harley spent an awesome time getting this feature up. We showed it last time, but even more stuff has been added. But as you can see, we can see everyone's work. So great job, everyone. Thanks for getting your projects in on time. We do want to, of course, do the same thing, point out the people who did, you know, a great job. So Foam and Hum, again, great job on the design work. Great use of libraries to get like great animations. Daniel, I think I have yours open somewhere here. Oh, no worries. Daniel actually implemented the most in terms of optional features. So really great job on that front. And we do want to point out both Tian and Bu as well. So I do want to point them out because they did come for office hours, which is super exciting, and we worked through some problems. So one of the things that we want to point out with Tian and Booz is that you know, like that if just a little bit more work on top of what they did would take it up a notch. So if they added more UI components such as animations and stuff like that, we would love to see you know, stuff like that as well, you know. But again, thanks for coming to office hours and working so hard on your project. But we also want to see just a little bit more as well, and it would be awesome. And we'd love to work with you guys on it. Sweet.
Chris, can you refresh that tab? Sorry, the green. Somehow they're just refreshing.
Refresh it?
Oh yeah, it includes like, you know, those who did a lot of optional features. The
right.
Boxes.
Yeah, exactly. So we see a lot of, so again.
If you haven't read them, it's, you haven't completed all the required features. So it's okay.
Okay, so yeah, let's move on to lecture then. Any questions? Any comments? So again, if you guys want some additional feedback, or if either me or the TAs can help provide additional info on how you guys can do better, like let us know. We'd gladly, you know, have a conversation with you. Okay, sweet. So today we are going to cover two things, well actually three things, networking, persistence, and actually threading. Threading seems to come up a lot, and it's something that we want to sort of talk about. I think it's what will take you from, you know, someone who can just do UI on Android to someone who can do pretty much everything. So most of you guys have worked with Retrofit, worked with, you know, like Android HTTP. So I'll sort of skip through that. But I think you guys remember last time when I created an async task. Is that correct? So can anyone give me a recap of what I did with async task? So what is an async task? It's going to be a repeat of last time. But Jessica? Explanation? So the last part. Okay, so anyone else want to give it a try? Async task?
I think that's why we need to do something that if you convince the world later, we'll be as fast we do have three primary methods, doing background in the charms we want to do, and this will do a charm in the background. It does depress the main trend, and he has a method to respond responsibility for update the progress of the work. And the last one is when the work of this we need to update the UI or do something after the work of this.
Yeah, so it's basically an asynchronous call that doesn't block your main thread, right? And also gives you progress and updates as well as needed. Let's say one of the things that we want to do is we want to take this URL, right? Let's find an image. So image.google.com, and I don't know. I like bulldogs, so bulldogs. Copy link address. Okay. So we have a new URL. URL equals. Oh, it's kind of big. Okay. So. We go back to take a look at this. Basically, what we want to do is basically use HTTP URL connection to go and go and get the image. So HTTP URL connection is actually synchronous, meaning it blocks. So that's the reason why we want to use an async task, is that we basically want to put all that work on the background, right? So if we just Google URL. Connection. And then the connection. And then for images, what we want to do is basically we want to get the input stream and then we want to convert it into a bitmap. Okay? Yeah. Stream and then bitmap factory decode stream, right? All right, so we basically have this round try catch. And this gives us a bitmap, so we can return that. And what's that? And on post execute, what do we want to do? Anyone? Ken? Make it what?
A toast.
A toast? Yeah. We're getting an image though. We're getting an image back. We can't just
set image.
Right, exactly. So let's find an image view, right? So
yeah.
I already in the layout before added. Whoops, I didn't add it here. But let's drop in. So let's basically drop in an image view. Image view in here. All right, let's make an IC launcher for now. Okay. Find view by ID, r dot. Image view. set image bitmap. Right? And then we can assign the bitmap here. Correct? And so let's run this. So can anyone describe what's happening in the background? I sort of went over it this last time. Daniel? Yes, that's correct. That is correct. I think I probably forgot. I forgot to add internet, huh? Sorry, Daniel. Sorry to interrupt. Right, so it's basically going to the background, but the important thing here is you have a UI thread, right? So the UI thread is actually a special type of thread. It's always running. So if we actually take a look at this CodePath document here, it basically describes what the UI thread does. So the entire point of the UI thread is it's always going to be running, and as things change, it's going to keep sending it to the screen, right? So it's always doing this work. And this is a specific design pattern that's being used where they have this message queue. So if you want to send a message or if you want the thread to perform some work, you have to basically send a message to the message queue. It will pop that message off the queue and then do some work on top of that. But the async task, on the other hand, what it's doing is it's creating a thread. It's making these HTTP calls, decoding the byte stream, the stream, and then creating a bitmap. But that thread is going to end, right? So if we take a look at what that looks like in async task, is that it actually holds onto a handler for the main thread. So this is a handler for the UI thread. And then what we have is a runnable, right? So this is a runnable that actually executes on this background thread. And then what happens when we're done, right? So on post execute. So let's see, where is that called? Right, so basically it's called on finish. And then if we take a look at where the get handler is called, it basically posts a message back to the original UI thread saying, hey, I'm done, and here's the result, right? So if we go back to this view, they're very different threads, right? One is has a queue on top of it, and the other is a very like, okay, use it, and then the thread is going to disappear. Does that make sense, everyone? So when you guys start working with cameras and stuff like that, that's when like this will come into play, because you can imagine if you're recording something, that's similar to like sending something to the screen. Okay, well, let's figure out why this is not working. Yeah. Yes. Okay. Yeah. Yep, that's right. And then execute, right? Oh, shoot.
Execute.
Yeah. And in this case, since we're already using the string, sorry, my bad. Cool. So we get the bitmap. And then if we continue, it's actually through an exception, huh? Yeah, through an exception. Whoops. So let's take a look at what that exception is. What? Okay, sorry. Sorry, what was that? That's weird. Huh. Just wonder what's going on. Sorry, guys. Okay. Well, it's supposed to work. okay. I'll come back and fix that later. But I think the important takeaway here is basically that is actually to understand what's happening in the background with the UI thread and, of course, the background thread. So remember, we're working with the future task, and it's basically making this call and decoding, and then we're going to write that bitmap into the image view. Sweet. So let's go skip over that and basically go into persistence. So how many of you guys worked with shared preferences? Shared preferences? So can you describe what a shared preference does? I see, so you're talking about sandboxing? Right, so shared preferences is basically, it's like a microdata store where you can basically sandboxes your data for your specific app. So we tend to use it to store like small pieces of data, for example, like the user ID if someone logs in. So if we actually take a look at how that works, so if we actually get the preference manager and get the default shared preferences, and we can actually just we can save some data into it, right? So we can call edit, we can say put string. So in this case, we can say let's say we want to keep track of like if a checkbox is saved or not, right? We can say is checked, and then the value is Alright, let's put boolean. Just checked. And then the value is like true or false, right? And then we commit. So let's actually integrate this with an actual UI component. So let's say we put in a checkbox, right? And the checkbox has checkbox ID. So private checkbox. Okay, so what do we want to do? We want to basically save this value whenever it's clicked, right? So we can say checkbox set on click listener and new on click listener, and then we can say we can take our preferences that we're setting here. Is checked. Correct? Right, so basically, whenever we check the checkbox, it's going to go to our shared preferences. It's going to set that boolean value, right? And then take the value of the boolean for if it's checked or not. So what else are we missing here, though? So we're missing a way to restore it, right? So basically, if we close the app and the app comes back, we have to go to shared preferences again, and we have to basically set the value. So in your onCreate, you can set checked, and then you can call it shared preferences, get boolean, and then is checked, right? And then we can default that to false. Okay, so let's run this. All right, so we clicked, right? It hit the breakpoint, we run, it's checked, but now what do? We should kill the app, right? To see if it restores. So you can go to app. So 3. You can force the app to stop. Okay, and then if we rerun. Right? So basically went, got the preferences, and then set it back. So shared preferences are good for certain data, but it's not good for data, for example, that large amounts of data. So can anyone sort of explain why that is? So What are our other choices besides shared preferences? Some of you guys use other methods for your pre-work? Database? Is there a specific one that you used in pre-work? SQLite? Okay. Some other people use a different strategy in their pre-work. Files, right? Right. You can basically read and write to a file. So what is a good example for using a database? What is a good example for using shared preferences? And what is a good example for using like a it's basically shared preferences, files, or database, right? So do you guys want to sort of guess why or talk about like trade-offs for each one? Anyone? Right, right, exactly. So we can sort of think of it like if you want indexable data, like things that have a lot of different properties, like a database would be good because it's very structured, right? But if you're simply storing like a boolean or a flag, like very small chunks of data, shared preferences would be great. If you're, for example, caching images, well, you don't need to throw that into the database. It'd be overkill because you would have like a data blob that you'd be throwing that in your data into. Instead, you could just write that to a file and retrieve it. Cool. Yeah.
Is it preference that if you're saved to files somewhere? It's just a small folder that the app is an app to store some small things.
Yep. No, that's a fair point. So it is, but the thing is that it actually retains it in memory. So shared preferences, if you actually look at the implementation, when you call get default shared preferences, it expands it. And this commit, so when you see this commit, there's different types of commits. So basically, what happens is it writes to memory, and then it decides when it wants to persist to the file. So it's very different from like writing to this directly, because you would basically just write, and then you wouldn't keep it in memory.
And then depending on what folder the app writes to, when you back up your phone or back up the app, it behaves differently.
Right. Right. So when you write to a file, you can write to either a sandbox location, which is inside of your app, or you can write to like a public directory. That's also different. So if you want somehow this data to be shared by other apps, you could potentially write that to a public directory and then have that read out. Cool. So let's go through and do a database example, okay? So let's call it DB helper. Okay, so what we need to do is create a helper. So basically, Android already has SQLite wrapped for you. And what they do is they allow you to implement these methods, right? So the two methods that you must implement are onCreate and onUpgrade. So can someone tell me what each one of these does for people who have experience? So who worked with SQLite? Daniel?
Yeah, I think onCreate is called when database is created, and onUpgrade whenever something in the database schema changes. For example, a new table or a new column, existing table.
Right. So onUpgrade is basically when you somehow change a schema or your data version, you have to run a migration. Okay, so we have to create a constructor here. Right. So let's do it this way. Constructor. And we'll just pass some context for now. So the first thing you have to do is basically give it a database name, right? So final string. And then we have to give a version. So Daniel, can you tell me how does the SQLite helper know when to call on upgrade? Right, exactly. Yep, so that's exactly it. Basically, whenever you change your code, so let's say I change it to 2 and I release, and the app upgrades, so you already have like a database file written or a SQLite database on your phone, it will look at that version and say, hey, is that version matching this version? And if it's not, then it will run this on upgrade. Okay, so on create, we're basically given a database, and we are going to execute some SQL. So I actually have that already created for us. So we're going to basically be storing a post. So in this post, we're going to have an ID. We're also going to have a username. And we're going to have some text for the post, right? And then we're going to generate the getters and setters. Okay, so then we want to create it basically in our on create, we want to basically create the table. So I'm actually just going to take this, which I've already created, worked on before, paste it in. So I'm not going to go into the details of SQL, but can anyone tell me what primary key does? No? Cannot duplicate. Okay. That's partially true. Yes, it has to be unique. It's also indexed, right? So basically, the database needs, like, can pull on this ID, and they can go grab the data really, really quickly. All right, so what we want to do now is what? We want to basically use this helper to basically create our database. Go to the slides and take a look at that. Shared preferences. Okay, right? So what we want to do is we actually want this to be a singleton. Does anyone know? So we briefly talked about what a singleton is, but can anyone tell me why we want this to be a singleton? Participation? Okay. Okay.
Think you know singleton.
Does anyone know? Yeah, so for people who don't know, closed fist, nose, open, unsure. Wavy? All right, ready? 1, 2, 3.
So,
so what? Why do you think it has to be a singleton? Call static method.
Single value. don't do any news, then you just get the flag and post it.
Okay. I don't think that's so. So re-explain, like, why do you think static methods would help here?
You just get a variable and without brain, then you can keep variable in the brain and then you can it.
Oh, I see. So yeah, that generally explains singletons, right? Is that it's something that you only need to create once, right? But so why in this case is it important for us to create a singleton? So database in general is like it handles a lot of different threads, right? And so actually, I think you're partially there, which is that in this case, I don't think a race condition will happen because I fully believe that Google implemented their SQLite helper correctly, and so it is multi-threaded, and it will handle multi-threading correctly. But the process of setting up a database is actually quite expensive because you're forming a connection to the database, right, or a connection pool, and you don't want to recreate that every single time, right? You only want to create it once, and then because databases are meant to handle a lot of connections or a lot of different threads or whatnot, you can just use that instance once over and over and over again without going through the expensive part of resetting up the connection pool to the database. Right, so the database is a separate process that's being run for you. It is sandboxed in your app, but it's not actually running as part of your app. So reconnecting to the database every single time is not a good thing. So we can call public get instance, right? So if what instance equals null, what do we do? Yeah. Right. Yep. So actually, that's what I was just going to talk about next. So, why would we add synchronized in here? Exactly. So it's potential. There's a potential that two threads could be calling get instance at the same time. So by calling synchronize, it actually puts a lock. It locks and says only one thread can access this function at any given time. Right? So that means there will only be one instance that is created. Otherwise, what would happen is if you didn't call synchronize, you could potentially see two threads get into the same point, both of them create, but only one gets assigned to this instance, and that would be bad too. Right? All right, that was a great question. That was a really good question. Does everyone understand how that works? Synchronize? Yes? It actually locks the entire class, so that it puts a lock on the class. Okay, so what do we want to do to store this? So we can create some helper functions, right? So we can say write post that will take post object and then we could do what? Read post, right? and we'll take an ID. Okay, so how does the helper work? What we can get is we can get a writable database. So there's a difference, right? If you want to write, you have to get a writable database. So basically, databases like optimize and help you. So writing in general is a blocking operation. If you write to the database, it actually like locks that row. So you don't want to, if it's just meant for reading, you should create a readable database. And if you want, you create a writable database so that the database will optimize accordingly. So we get SQL. This is a SQLite database, DB. And then in this case, we want to do an insert, right? Correct? So insert, let's, for this case, we'll call the And then what does this take? This takes this thing called content values. So we can do that here, right? Content values. Content values. Values. Put. What do we need to put? So we have all these fields, right? ID. Get ID. Username, and text, right? And then we write it. And then, actually, let's just make this read post so that we can... So what does read post do? Get a what? Readable database, right? And then what do we want to do? Where are you, right? Query, okay. So we could query, or we could actually do a raw query, right? So we could do something like select star from post table name. Cool. So what do we get? We get a cursor, right? So does everyone know what a cursor does? Exactly. So it basically allows you to like point into your results. Once you run the SQL, it points into the results, but doesn't move any data around. Does anyone know why you would have a cursor rather than maybe like a list of results?
Because it's faster.
Is that the reason?
Because like when the cursor point into the this
code. I just get that database based on the memory is not zero, but it's not fragment.
Is that the reason? Any other guesses? It's a good guess. These two are definitely good guesses.
So, like, when you query, so is that the cursor point to the table? Like, when you select star, like, select all from the table name, like, is the cursor, like, when it's pointing to the first?
Not necessarily. So what happens is, obviously, like, depending on what query you're doing, it'll make optimizations, but really it's rebuilding a set of data. But the entire reason why you have a cursor is because you can't put it in memory. Your memory is much small. Like, if you have a million rows in your database, if you were to take all of that and put it into memory, you'd be in a lot of trouble, right? Like, you basically, everything would crash. You would run out of memory. So the cursor is basically pointing in and saying, okay, you read as much as you need, right? That's why people do pagination too, right? They'll go and like only read the set that they want and then like put that into memory. So you don't, so that's why a lot of people, if like for example, you have a lot of data, you might say limit 1,000. Does that kind of make sense? So you basically aren't taking all of your data and putting it in the memory. If the SQLite database were to not behave that way, you can imagine like everything breaking if you loaded a data set that was too big. Okay? Okay, so how does this work? Cursor
move
to first, right? Move to first. So what happens is the cursor actually points at before. Like before the data set. So if they can't move to first, that means there's nothing there. That's how it works. Does that make sense, guys? And then so if it's already pointing to first, then you do a do while. Cursor, move to next. Okay, so what do we do here? We want to create a new post, right? Set ID. So what do you want to do? You want to get an integer. Cursor, get column index for column name ID. Does that make sense? Text. Yep. Cursor, get string. Cursor, get text. Oh, sorry. Yep. Set text. Right? And then one more. Oh, yep, sorry. Set username. Cursor. Get column name. Oh, sorry. Get column index. Yep, get string, and then get column index. Perfect. All right. So as you guys can see, I'm already doing something really bad, which is what? I am basically recreating this string every single time. What you want to do is you want to take all of those and actually put them as private static final. But you can imagine, like, as, and one thing I'm going to talk about right after this is, imagine if you have, like, this post having like 20 fields, what are you gonna have to do? Every single time you add a field to here, you're going to have to come to your helper and then add another field and fetch accordingly. Okay, so then this will return a list of posts. So list, I'll call it results. Class, and then results add p, and then what? Return results, right? Cool. All right, so let's give this a shot. Get instance, and let's write a post. Yes. And let's create a post. Let's actually generate a constructor. But then we also need a regular constructor, right? So let's just run this. Cool, hit the breakpoint, step over, run. All right, now let's go and fetch it, right? So let's implement that. So that method. Say on start. So if I were to run this again, what would happen? If I were to run this again right now, what would happen?
It would crash.
Why?
Because there's the same ID.
Exactly, there's the same ID, right? Primary key, someone mentioned uniqueness, it would crash. Okay, so then let's put a debug line here. Debug. Get instance this, and then read post, right? So we're going to get a list of posts. And post that size. Okay? Ready? Let's run. All right, cool. So let's continue. And then let's step over. Right? So we got two posts. Correct? Right, so that worked perfectly. So you can see how we are working with SQLite database to go get stuff. You can insert and get it back. So tell me what the problem with this setup is. Can anyone? Does that? First of all, does everyone get it? Hands open if they get it. Wave if okay. Close if not. Yes. Everyone gets this? Okay, so we briefly talked about why this becomes a problem if this gets really big, right? Let's say we add like another 5 fields, right? Like string 1, and then let's do a few things, right? Right? Imagine this being like 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. What would you have to do? It's someone who haven't called on. Again. Right. So you have to, every single time you have to go in, then you have to go and set each one of these. You're going to have to define another thing. What else are you going to have to do? That's actually not the biggest problem. That you can do in code.
So you have to play out the whole database, right? Because there is not there is no table field in there because the first day is only for like three fields, is ID, username, and text.
Right, so basically you start off here, you only have three fields, right? So now you have to migrate. You have to add in, like, so you'd have to literally say, if I change this to version, I would now have to change this to version 2 and say, if, you know, old version is this. Imagine if you have three versions. You have to, every single time, you have to do a migration. You have to say, from version 1 to version 2, what changed? From version 2 to version 3, what changed? And you actually can't even, you know, you don't really want to just change this create, right? So you have to basically go and make these changes. And you also have to change the create table for people who are just starting off. So it's a pretty, like, these migrations are problematic. So does anyone have potentially a better solution? So what type of data are you mostly getting in our API calls? JSON, right? We're getting JSON data. So the point of, like, for anyone who's worked with databases, databases are meant for a very generic sort of structure, right? You write stuff, but then you can go pull data back out differently. But for the most part, when you're working with an API, they're giving you the data in exactly the structure that they want you to operate on, right? You don't want to, like, break it up again and then, like, put it back together again every single time. So my recommendation is, if you decide to use SQLite, your table shouldn't look like this. So your table should probably look like this. And this is what I actually do a lot. JSON index 1, index 2. So think about this for a bit. Most JSON comes back, it's if you get an array of data, like, for example, this, the article search, they usually have an ID that can go here. Then you throw the JSON blob however you want into your field. But then you can say, well, I want to create an index off of one field inside that JSON, right? And then you can set that field for index 1, and if you want index 2, you can set that field. So that now you never have to run migrations for the most part, right? Because now you can say select off of index 1, like select JSON, and then take that JSON, and then basically now you have run it through JSON, and then you have a JSON object. You don't have to run migrations, right? You don't have to worry about version 1 to version 2, right? And for the most part, you're not doing heavy business logic in your app. You're simply just getting data and caching it. Does that make sense? Does it make sense? Makes sense.
What if the listener response is like mouse string? Is it wrong or impossible?
Is what?
Is it possible if the JSON is like a mouse string?
A lot of string?
Yeah,
so text fields store actually quite a bit of data. So yeah, you have there is a possibility that it might exceed the bounds, but for the most part, I don't think so, because you're still breaking it up. Like, if you get an array of JSON, you're still taking just that section of JSON and putting it in. So yes, it depends, but I don't think the chances of that happening are like good. So again, how many people understood, didn't understand? Kind of understand. All right, 1, 2, 3.
I have a question.
Yeah.
About this ID. So you said that just store a JSON, then return some app. Need to see data, like what you edit from compute in JSON and goes back to then. So
yeah.
We store a JSON.
Yeah, so it depends on how that update happens, right? If you update and you send a request to the server saying, please update just this field, right, then it comes back and then you write it back. It depends on your order. So if you decide to write to your database first and then write the and then make the API call to make that update, is that what you're saying?
See, later, like, we have a version, it, I mean, that, this is a, what is different in this?
So, well, I guess I don't quite understand, but just to clarify, this is not perfect for everything. Right. It's perfect. It's good for read-only data. When you're like, the article, that your homework two is a perfect example, right? You're really just consuming the data. You're not really modifying the data that much. If you are modifying the data, you should try to think of something else, and that's what we're going to move to next, which is Realm. But this is if you guys are dealing with pretty simple data where it's just read-only, to go and like break it apart and worry about migrations is probably too much of a headache. So I just see some people with closed fists or like this. So Jessica, can you tell me what I could, what you need an explanation of? Like, what can I?
Yeah.
Sure. So let's say we get back an array, right? Like this. So in here you'll have ID. Maybe like name, username, text. So what it's saying is because you can't do a where on JSON, but let's say you want to search everyone with the same username, you can simply say when you're writing to the database that I want to use index one for only usernames. So you write that extra field in. So in your write post, you would say, let's say, this was some JSON, right? It'd be JSON index one. You say p dot username, get username, and here would just be, I don't know, whatever it is, to raw JSON p, something like that. Does that make sense? Now you can, if I want to create a function saying, get me a list of posts, get by username. I can pass a string username like this, and then my query would be select star from post where index one equals username. Does that make sense? So most things, most times you're not trying to re-index, right? You only need like some, like one or two fields to get the data to show in a way that you care about. Imagine a filter, right? You want to filter by a username, or you want to filter by another parameter. So you basically take those fields and put them in the index fields. So now you don't have to run migrations, but you still have a quick way to take your data and bring it back. So this is basically converting SQLite from a relational database to a document database. Document meaning JSON in this case. Daniel, was that clear?
Yeah.
Okay. Cool. Everyone? Is that okay? Jessica? Okay, we'll talk afterwards. Okay, so as Tree mentioned, this is still not perfect for all use cases because sometimes we want to write data back, right? We want to make changes. The other thing about this is a very traditional database, right? SQLite has been around for a while. It's meant for you to create tables, to build relationships, and it's meant just as much for writing as reading, but there's a new project that came out called Realm. So who has heard of Realm? Okay, can you explain Realm? Why is Realm better?
Realm is a library, it's O-R-M library, it's
friend called Optus. Optus.
Relational mapping.
Relational mapping.
Is it? Is it? Is there a relational mapping? Yeah. So
exactly. Even,
yeah.
Is it Optus relational mapping? This means that we have objects created from a class, a child class, and when you have to say a query using the class, you need to use SQL.
Yeah, so there's a few things, right? Remember how I mentioned about traditional databases, how when you write, it locks? So there's a lot of different things, right? Exactly, like, so one, like, you're manually taking this data and remapping it to, like, an object, right? That's one situation. There are solutions around it. Actually, if I switch back to the slides really quick. Sorry, before I jump into Realm, let me take a step back and talk about some of these libraries for ORMs. So ORMs is basically taking this table and remapping it to an object, a POJO, a Java, a plain old Java object. So, Jen, I know you have experience with Hibernate. So, can you sort of describe this?
Right.
Yeah, exactly. So this has been around for a while, primarily on the server side. It is these annotations that you can add on your class, and it will know how to, it will perform code generation that will know how to go and grab the data from SQLite and remap it into this object. So the two annotations are either JPA or JDO. So those are two standards that have been defined for a long time when it comes to databases. So these ORMs basically leverage these two annotation definitions by Java to perform the ORM, the object relational mapping. Okay, so you can use this, but my suggestion is to not and to move over to Realm. So Realm does a lot of things. They do object relational mapping, but for them, they are a NoSQL database. So there's no, like right now what we're doing here is we're basically writing SQL commands, correct? And even like the ORM libraries that we talked about in this slide, they actually also convert your annotations into SQL. So Realm doesn't do that. Instead, it's designed for just pure speed. So they actually do like a memory mapping. They basically take your object and memory map it to data. So you can actually read, they have an entire document on how that works. So I would actually post it on lecture 3 and you guys can read up more about it. But it's extremely, extremely fast, right? So the thing about Realm is that they have one limitation, is that they want you to read everything from your UI code. So operations take nanoseconds in their case because they don't have to do any sort of data movement. So it's extremely, extremely fast. And so what they also want you to do is instead of making like an asynchronous call or like use a background thread to make a connection to a database, they said, we're fast enough so that, and everyone's using the like databases for caching, we want our read operation to be extremely, extremely fast that you can use on the UI thread. So basically, you can use Realm on the UI thread. Okay, so we're gonna just dive in and set up Realm. Okay, so we're gonna basically build the same thing, but we're gonna use it with, we're gonna use Realm. So if you go to docs, and you click on Java, getting started. So basically what you have to do is add this line to to Gradle. but at the bottom level. Okay? And then we want to apply this plugin. The app level. Okay, let's sync. Okay, so if we were to use Realm, basically similar, right? We create a post, but let's call it post Realm. What's our superclass? We extend something called the Realm object. Then getters and setters. So the one other thing that you can do is they have a primary key annotation, which says please ensure that there's no duplicates of this ID and index it. Okay, so the thing that's slightly different with Realm and the extra setups step that you need is SQLite is sort of comes with Android, right? All you have to do is extend the SQLite helper, and then you have access to the SQLite database. With Realm, it doesn't come as part of it, there's an additional setup step. So you actually have to extend the application class. So an application class is similar to activity, but just imagine its life cycle is for the entire duration of the app, right? Activity is just for that single view. Application has its own life cycle, but it's for the entire, as long as the app is alive, you'll have an on create and an on terminate. Okay? So the one step that you have to do on create of the app is call init. So this goes and sets up your Realm database, probably does some, file stuff, make sure that everything is working, and then also creates sets up this thread safe Realm object for you to use. So does anyone know how we let our app know to use this application versus the default application? Android manifest. So similarly, how you can specify a name here for an activity. You can specify a name here for app application. Does that make sense, guys? So basically, it's choosing to use your application instead of the default application. Okay, cool. So let's go to the activity. And let's comment this out. So we'll just delete it. Okay, so Realm init, what it does is it sets up this thread saved Realm database for you. And to get access to it, you call get default instance. Okay. So the one thing that they tell you to do is that you have to call db close whenever you finish using it. I will get back to this later. This is actually really, really important because db close can mess you up really badly. I'll explain why. Okay, so if I want to, for example, do the same thing, write post, Realm actually gives you a nice function where I can call execute transaction. So does everyone know what a transaction does in database? Transactions? Doesn't know? Knows? Not sure? 1, 2, 3. it's okay to do this. Okay, boom. Exactly. So, if you have, for example, have a lot, two objects that need to get written, and if one doesn't finish writing, you don't want the other one in, right? You want to. It's called a unit of work. You want both operations to all these operations to complete before, and if they don't, you don't want any of it committed. So you want to retry. So we can call execute transaction. New transaction. Okay. So here's the thing about realm though, is you can't call new post or new post realm in this case. Instead, you have to call create object. And then you have to pass post realm that class. Okay. And then I will call set text, which is hello, welcome to class, and post username. Okay, so why didn't I set ID here? So the reason why I didn't set ID here is because we marked it as a primary key. So that actually, it requires that you actually pass it in on create object. So when you call create object, it checks to make sure that there's no conflicts with your ID. Cool? Yeah. No, I don't think there is. The last time I checked, there wasn't. I have to double check. It's something that they want to do, but the last time I checked, they didn't have it in there. So there's two strategies around this. If you're creating an, if the ID is of course given to you by like your API request, that's easy, right? That's easily filled out. I actually use UUIDs a lot. Does anyone know what a UUID is? Okay, I will show you. let me comment this out really quick. Random UUID to string. And then let's just like this. So, UID, Tim, do you know? So what makes these UUIDs, what makes them different from like auto increment? Does anyone know? So UUIDs are interesting because they're designed to statistically, the chance of collision is very, very small. The chance of collision, so right now, like if you have an auto increment, what happens? You have to remember the last one and then plus one, right? But if you're basically creating them, see, it generates this very complex ID. This ID statistically, if you're writing a lot of data to a database, the chances of it colliding is almost zero. So you don't have to worry about saving and all that stuff. So it is kind of overkill because this is designed for a backend server. But doesn't it hurt to like just generate a UUID and use that because you want conflict. Okay? Does that make sense? Okay.
So basically like we're using UID instead of ID, right?
Well you can basically in a database there is a UUID type, or you could just pass it in and save it as a text string. Either way.
Yeah, so like what if I want to look for ID?
Yeah, you would just search. You would search off the ID, right? It was still searched just fine. I mean, it's not as fast as an integer comparison, but that's the only in order to prevent collision, that's probably it's probably better. Okay, so let's go back and run this. And then we are going to go get that data, right? So again, we are going to call realm get instance realm db. And again, I'll talk about this a little bit later. There is a reason why I am actually putting this in my activity instead of creating a separate class for it. And I will show you guys in a bit why that's the case. Okay. Okay, so in order to get the data, you call where post realm dot class equal to field name. Let's call just find all. Okay? We can just call find first to get this. Post data. All right, you guys ready? Let's run it. Okay, so we're writing now. And now if we take a look at the debug, we get our post, right? You guys can see that, right? ID, username, welcome, right? Great, so similar to SQL or your SQLite database, you can get it really easily. So why use realm? The nice thing about realm is that if you write, you can actually observe these objects. You can observe changes, right? So I can actually, on this realm, this post object, I can actually watch it, right? I can add a change listener. This is really, really powerful, right? Because remember how we were talking about MVVM and all that stuff? Let's say you write to a model on some other place that you're using it. You can watch for that change and then perform actions on top of it, right? And so this actually kind of deals with what Tree's talking about, which is, well, what if I want to create these little updates to this object? How will I know, right? How does that work? Well, so realm is really nice because it does that for you, right? You can observe it and watch for changes, and then automatically perform actions on top of it. Does that make sense? So even if, for example, you have a background thread that changes the object, your UI can watch for it, right? Imagine if you have a connection to this data, the database, and you keep pulling for changes, and then it changes. You write to this realm object that it changed. Your UI can detect that change and immediately change your UI accordingly. Does that make sense? Make sense? Doesn't make sense? Make sense? Okay, cool. So why did I harp on this DB close? Okay, watch. Watch what happens when I move this line. to afterwards. Doesn't crash, but it does something really weird.
It's return null.
So put a break there. Oh, sorry, it's going to crash because I didn't change this to 2. But. Sorry. But, you're right. You're right, it's going to crash. okay, so we wrote, right? We close. We have a valid post object right now. Let's step over that. Invalid object. Right? When you close your data, so what happens is this get default instance, it actually creates a holder to the Realm database. Per thread. It's something called thread local. For people who want to understand how this works in Java, thread local is a singleton per thread. Singleton per thread. Okay. You guys can read about the details here. This is really, really important. The problem is that if you just call close, after you go get your data, you've just lost the entire benefit of, well, first of all, you lost your data, so you can't use it. But you also lost like the ability to observe that data, right? Because now it's closed. So when is the right place to call DB close? DB open. Tricky, right? This is the tricky part.
So.
So first of all, does everyone understand what's happening here? Close. Yes? No? Okay. So you can imagine, right, the entire purpose is that, like, the Realm is doing a lot for you, right? It's the reason why it's not just a regular database is because it's not just transferring data back for you. It's also creating objects for you. And these objects are observable, right? So you want to usually take advantage of this property. Not only that, like you want the object to be readable in the first place. So a lot of people, what they'll do is they'll create like a value object. Like they would take this post realm and like assign it to this post. That's terrible, right? You've just lost the entire benefit of what Realm is doing for you, which is becoming is basically creating these objects for you that you previously had to manually do with SQLite. So there's this really interesting concept called unit of work. It's a design pattern you guys should look into, but the thing that you want to do is you want to correctly scope when you open and close your database. So really this realm, because we're accessing the UI thread, it should be activity scoped, right? You should close on stop. On destroy. Or on destroy. Depends. You should be careful. I think on stop is probably the right place, right? Because on destroy is like when it actually like gets rid of the object completely, but you might does that make sense? But now what happens if you go and access Realm from another thread? Or what happens if now you want to pass this object from this activity to another activity? Remember, what did we do during lab 2? We use like serializable, we use parsable, right? Unfortunately, you can't do that here because this is an in-memory object. Don't copy it to this and transfer that over. Please don't do that. Again, Realm is supposed to be fast. Pass the ID over, relook it up. It's super fast, right? Pass the ID, like, I need this object, pass it. It's already cached, right? Pass the ID over and then read it out. It's much, much faster. And you also get the ability to observe. Don't try to like serialize it or put this into some package that you can use. Cool. The other thing is if you have a separate thread, again, that if you have if you create a runnable, say I create like a new runnable, you would call inside here, again, you would call realm. You call realm get default instance, and then you execute your actions in here. Like you execute your actions in here, and then you call close at the end. Okay. So remember how I specified? There's a reason why I actually talked about this threading, right? One is a looper thread, which is a very special case. It's always there. So you have to manage it. Like that's why like there's an activity scope. But then you also have these individual threads that just end and terminate. And so you want to manage it separately. Does that make sense, guys? Jessica, no? Okay. Okay. I'll talk with you afterwards and try to explain it a little bit better. All right, so we should take a break right now for a few minutes, and then we can move on to the next thing.